Hello, I'm Matt Peterson.
And I'm Rich Trapeer.
And this is episode 45 of History on the Table. We got a wild one tonight, folks.
Yeah, we both got lots of games played, and there's, for no surprise, but there's a lot of overlap in our games played.
Yeah, not only did we play a lot of games, we played a lot of games together.
Yeah, it was great.
Yeah, it really was. We also have some game company news. We have two games to review. We got all kinds of stuff going on. But what's new with you, Rich? I don't want to jump the gun. How are you?
I'm good. Did some singing today. We've got a lot of singing coming up. We are singing again next weekend. So, yeah, it's good stuff. Yeah, we're actually singing at a big fundraiser gala next week, so that'll be fun.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Good. All right. Let's get into it. I think where we should start is just announcing that the Historical Board Game Awards fan vote, those will go live shortly after the 28th of February. Bill and I are working hard on that. There are still, I think we're down to 3 ballots outstanding from judges. So we're close to being done. And I think everything is more or less automated at this point to just plug in and then we'll do a double check. Anyways, we will tweet out and maybe even do a little podcast plug for it. But that'll just be over Google Forms and that will run through March, nice. I believe. It'll have a due date, whatever it is.
Looking forward to seeing. Yeah, it was interesting. I did my ballot and my first thought was, man, I should have played more actual 2023 games. But you know how it is. There's when we do our end of the year thing, it's like new to us. But
right.
Obviously for this, new to us isn't good enough. So it had to be an actual 2023 game.
Just as 2022,
yeah.
That would be harder. First off, let me real quick as a quick aside say thanks to Aardwolf for having me on his show with Harold Buchanan to talk about just historical game award things. And I mentioned this there. I think this year will be a lot easier because now I have a full year of having it in my mind. You know, this idea came to us last fall and we put the pieces together and there just wasn't as much build-up time. I've been working my pants off to play the 2022 games I wanted to play. But now I know, and now I'm keeping an eye out like, oh, that's a 2023 game that I think I'm really going to like. That's going to take some priority. So now we have 12 months instead of a much abbreviated period. Did you struggle with your ballot at all?
A little bit, especially on, I think the small game one,
sure.
There was really only one that kind of stood out for me. And, mostly it's just because I couldn't think of any other small games. But and the one I think was deserving of the spot I gave it, the number one spot. It was good, but I think that one I only put one on the ballot.
There's been a few games, and I don't want to spoil anything, and we've both intentionally, Bill and I have intentionally not spent too much time looking at results until the deadline's passed. But just in coming up with formulas and kind of cleaning up everyone's results. So if everyone votes for U.S. Civil War, we're making the names uniform so they all say U.S. Civil War instead of USCW, obviously. U.S. Civil War not eligible, but you get the idea.
Right.
There's been a couple games that I had never even heard of, which has been interesting, and I'm like, why is no one talking about this game? Because they look pretty interesting. Other than that, it's kind of a little bit as, I wouldn't say as expected, but I'm not terribly surprised by the front runners, but all of that will be revealed in just a few days. So, okay, we had another competition that was a little more fun. Well, no, this is fun too, but it was just as fun, a little more loosey-goosey, I should say, and that was the Every War Game Ever fan vote. So Rich and I have our list of Every War Game Ever. We took that list, and we put it in a bracket, and we ran that through our Discord, and every day there was one or two votes to vote between two games, and the winner advanced, and the loser was knocked out. It was March Madness a month early. And that is done.
It is.
And we have a 2023 winner.
And what game, do people agree with me, is the best game of all time, Matt?
The Pacific War.
That's right.
GMT Games.
Justification.
I picked that as my overall winner just because, and I also had U.S. Civil War going down way earlier. U.S. Civil War made it to the semifinals. U.S. Civil War finished 8th last year, so I was pleasantly surprised by that. And we did prediction brackets, and congratulations to Justin B. He won a gift card to Noble Knight as the overall winner with getting the most accurate predictions. I had a lot of fun with it. It was fun.
Yeah. It's funny, though. I mean, there's probably a little bit of Cult of the New in it. Pacific War is definitely the hotness right now. But
sure.
It's funny with the U.S. Civil War, that one needs to come back to my table soon, because I don't think I played it at all last year. And usually I play that usually once a year for that game. So that one's going to have to come back to my table. Pacific War will as well. But I think U.S. Civil War will be one of the next games I put down.
Oh, I love to hear that.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was. I think we mentioned it last episode. There was the Men of Iron upset,
mm-hmm.
which is disappointing. No respect for that.
What one last year? Fantastic. Do you remember?
So last year we did a little bit different. We combined things, and GCACW won last year. So
yeah, and there was I think it was Gettysburg. One of the GCACW games I know was in the Final Four.
Exactly, Roads of Gettysburg 2. So the Final Four were Pacific War against U.S. Civil War, against Roads to Gettysburg, against
Empire of the Sun.
Empire of the Sun.
That was in there too, yeah.
Yep, and then with Pacific War knocking off U.S. Civil War and Roads to Gettysburg knocking off Empire of the Sun.
Yeah.
Here, I pulled up the results real quick. So last year, GCCW got first, OCS was second, Empire of the Sun was third, Next War was fourth, DNB and Fu was fifth.
Yeah, all good games.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we have a top heavy list for sure.
So what's next? Every series ever?
No. Here's the deal. I lost almost all interest in that when people started arguing over what a series was. Like, well,
didn't that start from an argument over what a series was, though?
Well, no, that was a joke with whether ASL was or not.
Yeah.
And then we booted all. So then I made the mistake of asking for input. And then it turned into, like, if a company is calling something a series, is that not enough for it to be a series? If they're like, even if there's only a little bit of stuff for it? And I mean, no shame, people have their opinions, but the argument that coin isn't a series is when I said, I'm not doing this.
Feel free to do it yourselves. I'm out.
Yeah. Yeah, like, there's 96, I don't remember what we got up to, 96 series entries.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
Like, let's be realistic, past the top 32, they probably don't matter. And GCACW would probably win. I don't know. That is my prediction. But, yeah, I'm not messing with it. If someone else wants to, go for it.
Probably, that or OCS. Those are one of those two. Yeah,
sure. It was kind of cool to, like, drum up some, like, to really round out the list, to like really drag the list of series, because there's some wacky stuff out there.
Yeah.
All right. So that was that.
And coming up with names of series that kind of are series, but don't really have a name to them. So.
Yeah, you may know this now, but I did not know before. Do you know the name for the downtown series?
I think I saw someone. Was it just called like Downtown Air or something like that?
Yeah. Okay. That's how GMT lists it. Okay. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
And then there's also the struggle of A Greater Victory just came out, right? Or they had the Kickstarter for the second printing of it. Hey guys, it's Matt chiming in, doing Patrick, the office administrator's work. I meant A Most Fearful Sacrifice, second edition from Flying Pig Games. That is technically a series, but there's only one game in it. And so that's called Black Swan, which is interesting. I don't know where that comes from. But
well, isn't Atlantic Chase, isn't that volume one?
Yeah, right.
So, same thing.
Anyways, who knew that the What is a Wargame series would be as polarizing and as pointless as What is a Wargame? All right, let's get on track. Let's talk about games. We got a lot to talk about.
Yeah.
My shelves, I'm going under like a massive purge to make sure everything fits on a shelf.
Yeah.
So I did not add anything while I'm on, because that seems really counterproductive to what I'm doing.
Well, I tried.
And you purged.
I started to purge, I sold off a few games, which was good because, you know, same thing. I was trying to create some shelf space, as well as I'm trying to save up money because I want to go to New Zealand next year. So I ended up selling a few, and then Bruce put up some games that I couldn't avoid taking. So I picked up actually the entire Last 100 Yards collection from him. All three volumes plus the scenario pack. So I figure I'm still coming out ahead. I've got more shelf space and fewer games than I started with, but those were good ones. It's funny, when I sold Last 100 Yards, I remember not long after thinking, this is going to be the first game ever that I buy back after I sold.
And I think you've said that.
And that is the case. This is the first time I've ever bought a game that I sold. And not only that, but I bought volumes 2 and 3 in the battle pack as well. So I regret nothing.
Solomon Islands is so good when you awesome. Dive into it. Nice. How he's handled the Japanese is brilliant.
Yeah.
I was having a conversation with some guys playing Panzer Grenadier mm-hmm. the other night. And Art asked the about Last 100 Yards. The one from Avalanche Press.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay.
My summary is, we've talked about this before, is just Last 100 Yards is tackling tactical in a way that other series aren't.
Yeah.
There's big differences between ATS and ASL, but they're essentially doing the same thing. Myke Denson has just made other things relevant and important in that series that really breathes some new life into tactical, especially, not that ASL or ATS were dead in any sense of the word. There's still plenty of people playing them, but it's something different. It's not an ASL clone. It's not an ATS clone. It's not, you know, Band of Brothers is very much in that lineage, and Last 100 Yards is very different.
Yeah. Yeah. So like I said, I regret nothing. I'm going to keep selling off some more games, but I'm glad to have Last 100 Yards back in the collection.
Awesome. All right. What about reading? I see a theme here.
I know. Yeah. And I think this theme may come back to life when we get to our games that we want to play next month. But actually, so I started and finished, because it wasn't a very long book, a pretty interesting book called Legion versus Phalanx by Myke Cole. Have you read that one?
No, but I've heard it talked about before. Yeah, so I think on Chance of Game.
It's really lightweight. It's honestly, it's like a battle study, or it's like, I think 6 battles in the book. And I think every single one of them is in SPQR. So I kind of want to play SPQR because I want to play these particular battles. But I think it's 6 battles, and every single one of them was the Greek phalanxes versus the Roman legions. And it just goes over the course of, you know, I don't know, 50 or 75 or 100 years, something like that, whatever. Where they go over these battles, and sort of the premise of the book is that the Legion won out, because early on the phalanxes were just kicking the crap out of the legions, but the legions were more flexible by design and also maybe culturally as well. So ultimately the legions were able to adapt not only to different battlefield conditions, but just over time, and the phalanx was never able to adapt, and that's why the Legion ultimately won out. So it was a pretty good book. It was, like I said, it was lightweight. It wasn't very long, but it was interesting.
Nice.
And then that just kind of got me on an agent's kick. So I'm reading the Caesar biography by Adrian Goldsworthy. It's called Caesar, Life of a Colossus. And it's pretty interesting. A few things I hadn't heard before, but I've read a decent amount on ancient Rome, especially the Roman Republic. So, and nothing groundbreaking so far. And he said, even at the beginning of the book, I'm only about maybe a third or a halfway through it. But he said at the beginning of the book, this is not going to be about his military campaigns or anything. This is not a military history book. It's really more about him and the late Roman Republic and, you know, that type of thing. So, but it's really good. I mean, I've heard good things about it. I know he's a well-known author, and it's well-written, and it's entertaining.
Yeah, you know, I picked up his and started his Fall of Carthage book when I did my little cabin getaway thing. Mm-hmm. And I haven't gone back to it, which is a real shame, because I agree. He is a very entertaining writer.
Yeah.
My one complaint with Adrian Goldsworthy is when you go to pick up one of his books... Mm-hmm. He changes titles from edition to edition. So the first edition of Fall of Carthage is called The Punic Wars, mm-hmm. and then it's called The Fall of Carthage, and that's not his only book that does that. And so it's kind of like, oh, that one sounds interesting too, and then you come to find out it's the same book. And anyways, I really like the little bit I read of that, more than I thought I would.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a really long book, and my first thought was it was probably going to be dry, and it's not. It's entertaining. I mean, it talks about the personalities of the people. It talks about like all their sexual affairs, and I mean, it's all the scandals and everything. It's a good book.
Nice. Well, speaking of things that you thought would be dry, that's kind of what I thought when I picked up the Franco-Prussian War, the German conquest of France in 1870-1871 by either Geoffrey or Geoffrey Wawro, mm-hmm. W-A-W-R-O. One, I would never read this book if it was not for playing at any cost Metz. This is generally like 1800s. Europe is not my favorite thing to read about.
Yep.
And this looks like when you go order it off Amazon, it kind of comes across as like a course book because you can rent it, which I haven't seen before. I rent it on my Kindle. Anyways.
Oh, interesting.
Way better than I thought it was going to be. Very readable, very entertaining. I'm actually not quite done with it, but I'm reading this one in paper. I think that's the only way you can get it. Very good. And I'm finding this particular era of history more interesting than I thought it would.
Nice.
Yeah. Sweet. Any other books?
No. Not historical. We'll talk about another one later.
Sure. All right, let's talk about games. So let's set the scene here. We were lucky enough to be able to get together with some buddies for a little lake getaway.
Absolutely.
A couple weeks ago. And the game plan was to feature one main game a day. And so that's the order I put them on the list for us to go through. It makes the most sense to me.
Yeah, sure.
Like the order we played them.
John Company first, though, didn't we?
Oh, we certainly did. Yeah. So let's start with John Company. So I've talked about John Company. That was my runner-up last year behind Pacific War, is my favorite game. It's a historical-themed game where you're controlling a family in the East India Trade Company. And you take on all these different positions in the company and you try to put your family in the best position to eventually retire them and get victory points and a whole bunch of negotiating. So I've talked about it. Everyone knows I like it. What about you, Rich? What did you think?
Yeah, I loved it. It's a fantastic negotiation game. I mean, it's up there with Here I Stand, Twilight Struggle, trying to think of some other negotiation games. I mean, Pax Pamir, which is same designer, but a much smaller game, but along with those. John Company is kind of cool because you can play a shorter scenario that's probably going to go 2-4 hours, or you could play like the entire life of the company, which, assuming the company doesn't fail, mm-hmm. which is a big, big assumption, it could be an all-day game. So it's good. I liked it quite a bit.
Yeah, tons of fun. And a great just product. Like, it's very well produced.
Oh, yeah.
And highly recommended.
Yeah.
And there's a great teaching video out there as well. Yeah. If you want to check that
out. We'll talk about this in a minute, but I mean, as good as it was the second best negotiation game of the weekend. So
I think I agree with you. The more I think about it. Yeah. All right. But before we get to that, let's talk about a game I know we've talked about wanting to play in the past before, a little revisit to Coin, and that's A Distant Plane. Had you played this before? I can't remember.
Nope, this is one of the two or three that I have not played, so I was anxious to play that.
Yeah, so this is early in, when you look at things now, early in the Coin lineage, but this is a Coin entry covering Afghanistan. It's co-designed by Volkan Runke and Brian Train. One player takes on the coalition forces, one player takes on the Taliban, the government, and the last one is the warlords.
Yeah.
And it's Coin, and it's Coin. It's literal counterinsurgency.
Yeah.
I love this. This was very good.
Yeah, it was fun. And Coin, you know, a few years ago, I was just absolutely in love with Coin. Like, up until the time that I think India came out, I owned every single one of the games because I loved them all. And, well, actually, I didn't own Distant Plane, and I didn't. I think that's the only one I hadn't owned, and then Andy and Abyss is the other one that I haven't played up until then. But, yeah, for some reason, I just sort of lost my interest in Coin, started moving on to other things. But it was nice to sit down and play this face-to-face because Coin at the table, face-to-face on paper, really is a great experience. I mean, it's a fun game to play if everybody is involved. It's so much, you know, it's whack-a-mole, it's negotiation, it's trying to find ways to screw somebody over so you can get that one extra victory point. Like, the entire game, I'm just sitting there trying to convince you guys that I was nowhere near winning. And, you know, then I started making my move to the end and I started tried to do it quietly. So yeah, it's fun.
Yeah. And I felt like once someone was started to position themselves to win, which was Mitch. Mitch made the first move, right? He pulled all the coalition forces off.
The coalition, yeah.
Yeah, and then things were very tense after that.
Yeah, which is funny because to do that, he has to basically get all his guys off the map, which can put him in a place to win, but also gives him no control over what we do anymore.
Right, right. And then he's got to build, although him building back up isn't actually that difficulty. Yeah. It's not like it sets him back majorly. I don't know if this is my favorite coin. It is a little long, but
I think,
gosh, it's got to be in my top three. And then it's a pretty big drop. Like, top three are coins I'll play and want to play on, like, regular basis. After those first top three coins, there's a big drop off in my interest after that.
Yeah. I like Fire in the Lake the best. I like Falling Sky just because I think it's interesting going back to Ancients, and it was the first one I played. I think all coin games, though, kind of drag at some point. You know, they start off good, and then toward the middle they kind of drag, and then you get into the end game where everything picks up again. But it is a long game. I mean, all of them, if you play the full, you know, four or five propagandas or whatever it was, we probably went 8 hours for this one, I'm guessing.
Yeah, we took a lot of breaks and stuff, but yeah, this was an all-day affair on Friday.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
Yeah, it was fun.
Had a good time with it. All right, let's talk about the big one.
Oh, yeah. And so this one we played, well, 14 hours.
14 hours.
Because you won after like 6 hours, and we were having so much fun that we decided to pretend you didn't and keep going.
Yeah, and then that you know, so we're talking about Republic of Rome. Which is, it's set in the early Republic. Again, you're not representing a family, you're representing a coalition of families. And so you may have people die or, you know, go be a governor somewhere. And it's this 250-year stretch. And so it's kind of abstract in that sense. But basically, you're negotiating nonstop with putting forward laws, you're voting on who is
voting people into offices.
Yeah, what am I I can't think of the word. Who's
consuls,
in charge of the military?
The field
yes,
council,
thank
the
you,
Rome
consuls.
Council.
Exactly. And so we wrapped up. I won and we're like, let's keep going. We're here, let's do this. And it allowed me to like change my perspective and play the game differently. This was we talk about this. You know, these memorable game experiences. Our play of Republic of Rome will always go down as one of the best gaming experiences I've ever had.
Yeah, like when we get to the end of the year and we're looking over the course of the year for the best gaming experience of the year, I'd be shocked if something tops that.
I'd be shocked if anything tops this as my game of the year.
Yeah.
If I'm being completely honest.
Yeah, it was
and
great.
And for Historic Fest, I'm going to order Founding Fathers.
So it's interesting. We our monthly gaming day next month for St. Louis Historical Gaming Society. We ended up having to cancel it because Miniature Market said we don't have space. But that was the one of the first games someone recommended was Founding Fathers, and I was like, yes, I want to play that.
Now, which Founding Fathers was it though?
I don't know. I don't know. There was more than one version. I just know
there is.
Okay.
There's a Jason Matthews and Christian Leonard version, very different.
Oh, okay.
Not, and that's like a multiplayer game that just plays in like 2 hours.
Oh, okay.
And that's got a picture of a bust of one of the Founding Fathers. I don't remember who's on the front of it, but it's like a statue.
Okay.
The Founding Fathers, that's like Republic of Rome, shows a bunch of the Founding Fathers like shaking hands.
Interesting. I'll have to ask him that because I knew that Founding Fathers was similar to Republic of Rome. I didn't know there was more than one version.
Yeah, most of the time when people are talking about Founding Fathers, they're talking about the Jason Matthews game.
Yeah.
So, which may be good, but obviously not what we're looking
right.
for. Yeah, so Republic of Rome was phenomenal. And I did want to, and Rex reminded me, he did saw. So we had two things going for us. He gave us a little more cash to start the game.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had incredibly lucky draws to start the game. We had very few wars to start out. And so I think he mentioned that to like allow us to reevaluate our kind of like expectations of the game.
Sure.
But the more I think about it, the more, like, if things are tense, if you're really low in cash, or if you really have a bunch of pressing wars, so you, like, you have to go fight your wars. You can't let wars go unresolved. The Republic will fall, and then, you know, you can have, people can rebel, and they can take their shot and win the game. Whatever. It's a fantastic game. But I think that just gets ramped up and make me enjoy the game more if the decisions are harder. Like, if there's more pressure on every single player,
yeah,
I think it's... So what did you like more, John Company or this?
Oh, Republic of Rome, no doubt.
Okay.
Yeah. That would be one that I would, like, try and... It's hard to be able to play a 14-hour game, but Republic of Rome would be one that anytime someone wanted to play and, like, we're going to commit, even if it's going to be a two-day weekend game or whatever, I would try to make that happen.
Yes, I agree. And if we had, you know, six competent and willing, able-bodied players, and someone said, then obviously this will change from year to year. Like, if it's been 5 years since I played Here I Stand or something like that. But if you had that weekend lined up and someone says, hey, we have six people and everyone knows how to play the game, we don't have to do a big teach or anything.
Sure.
Do you want to play Republic of Rome or do you want to play Here I Stand?
Republic for Rome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's a little bit of the, like, the new hot thing that's in our minds, I'm sure. But yeah. It was that.
But I mean, memorable. I liked it so much that, you know, Twilight Imperium is one of my top, I don't know, definitely top five games of all time. Uh-huh. But Republic of Rome, I would... It's a tough decision which one I like more.
We're going to have to dive into this one. Yeah. And I think you go fight wars, so I think it qualifies for the list.
Yeah. It's going to be high. I mean, we both said we like it more than Here I Stand, so that puts it in top 10.
So far, I do. Yeah, yeah. I want to play it with maybe a little less extra cash to start the game.
Yeah. Six players would be more interesting, too, because like we talked about in our sort of post-mortem of the game, you know, more votes spread around. So that'd be good.
Yeah.
Makes it harder for one person to control the floor.
Again, I'm getting a copy of Founding Fathers. I'm going, once that's in, and I dive in the rules and make sure it at least gets close to the Republic of Rome itch. So it's a spinoff of Republic of Rome covering the Founding Fathers of the United States.
Yeah.
So you'll start with George Washington as president, John Adams as vice president, and you go from there. If it all looks good, I'm going to add it to the menu for Historic Fest options, and it plays up to six. So if you're coming to Historic Fest this August and you want to join, jump in it.
Yeah.
Assuming I get it up.
Nice.
All right. We both have a couple games we played on our own.
Mm-hmm.
I want to mention High Treason, just because we spent all of last January talking about these small form games, short games, whatever you want to call them, and this is right in that vein. It's not conflict-based so much, but it is from the old Victory Point games, and it's High Treason, the Trial of Louis Riel.
Oh, that's the one you had on the table in the other room there that you were playing before we got there?
Yeah, okay. So Rex and I played two games of this back-to-back. I actually don't know what Rex thought of this game. I really liked it. You know, if we kind of put it up in that list of the small games we played, it's probably like second or third in those. Again, it's not a historical conflict. It's actually this trial, and one side's playing the defense, one side's
playing... So it's not a historical trial, or it is?
It is a historical trial.
Okay, okay.
It's not a war game.
Got
it's not it. A conflict game.
Okay.
One side's playing the prosecution. You're manipulating... So, like, each juror will have three background stouts, their language, their religion, their profession, and you kind of influence these gauges to make sure that all the Catholics sway to your side or all the Protestants sway to your side. And there's very distinct phases of the game, and you try to influence certain jurors the most. And if you influence a juror, that juror, then when they go to deliberation, will influence other jurors. Plays pretty quick, especially I think once you know it, you probably knock this out in 30 minutes. I really liked it. That's High Treason, the Trial of Louis Riel.
Nice.
All right. You got one more.
Yeah. So at our game day, which is, I think, just last week, I can't remember when it was, we actually played Plains Indians Wars, which you played last year. And I think I liked it more than you did. It was interesting. We played four player. My wife played with me. So anytime she plays a game with me, I'm probably always going to like it a little more. As I was playing, I hated the dice because, like, everything you did felt so fruitless, And then, like, at the very end of the game, all four of us, who this is like our first time playing, all four of us about at the same time realized that the two Plains Indians tribes and the settlers and the Cav can combine dice.
Right.
And that makes a world of difference. Because, like, every time we had to attack, I was playing the Southern Plains Indians. Every time we had to attack a wagon, you get two dice. And you have to roll two hits to kill the wagon. And most of the time, if you don't, the wagon is going to move even further. So, like, any space with a wagon, all you're doing is helping your opponent. But then when we realize that, like, literally the last turn, we're like, oh, on four dice, it's a whole lot easier to get two hits. So, made a big difference. And I want to play it again knowing that rule. Overall, like, as I was playing it, I was very frustrated with certain aspects of it. But overall, I thought it was basically a fun little game.
So I don't like this game.
Yeah, I know.
I really like the Birth of America series a whole lot more. I think the battles are more fun.
Yeah.
And that's what a game like this comes down to. It's supposed to be this die chucker, right? You have all these cubes and they crash into each other and you see what happens. The battles here can just end without any kind of real resolution, and then that track of, like, the people going west not advancing can just be brutal.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, there was a lot of times during the game that I was very frustrated with it. It would have made a big difference if we had played that one rule correctly. Maybe not a big difference, but a difference. Overall, I thought it was a light, sort, basically easy to comprehend game for four people to sit around and play over the course of 3 hours.
Nice.
So, yeah.
All right, sweet. So we have more to go. We're also, gosh, I didn't even mention we're talking about our most anticipated games of the year. So we're going to skip the Wargame game tonight because we have two featured games.
Two
of them. So, and we've talked about it. It's at Any Cost Metz and Fortress America. I think we would just start with At Any Cost Metz.
Sure.
You ready to dive into it?
Absolutely. I love this game.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a 2018 release from GMT Games, designed by Herman Lettman, covering the, as I mentioned earlier, the Franco-Prussian War. And if we set the table real quick, this is not a conflict I know much about. I'm learning so much as I'm reading this book. But essentially, is France kind of helped create a beast that they couldn't contain in the form of Prussia.
Yeah, so
and
France declared war on Prussia, France thinking that they were the superpower in Europe, and I think Prussia won the war in, what, like 2 weeks? They were in Paris was, 2 weeks later.
It was not very long. And so this game covers two of the major battles of the Franco-Prussian War. As Rich said, you know, Prussia had just got done stomping Austria, and this was France's, I think, kind of attempt to be like, oh shit, what have we done? And to kind of put Prussia in check. And so this covers two of those battles. What's interesting from this, like, historical perspective. So this is obviously it's late 1800s. You have some new military technology, the French rifles, you have the first machine gun, which is represented in the game. That's all awesome. Reading Herman Lettman's design notes, he made an interesting point. I've never played a game on this topic. If you look at this at any other level than tactical or slightly above tactical, whatever we're at, Prussia just rolls over France, right? But he zooms in on the Battle of Mars-la-Tour and the Battle of Saint, not as easy to remember, I don't remember what it's called, the other battle covered in this game, that it becomes a lot more interesting because France did inflict a shit ton of casualties. They just had terrible leaders.
Yeah.
And they probably could have won. I don't know if should have is the right phrase to use, but they had a fighting chance. So if you kind of change that up a little bit and you zoom in, it does, and I think he did successfully, make a very interesting game design in this otherwise total blowout historical period.
Yeah.
Any other thing to add historically?
Well, this comes into gameplay as well, but I think one of the really cool things about this battle historically is the French had excellent riflemen, and the Prussians had excellent artillery, and there's an asynchronicity to that that plays out well in the game and is really mm-hmm. interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess backing up just a little bit, so this is in the Blind Swords system. Mm-hmm. It is slightly different, especially in combat resolution.
If you've played all the Civil War Blind Swords games, you'll recognize it, but the CRT is quite different.
And the playability of the command chits is different. So if you're unfamiliar with Blind Swords is a chit draw game, meaning you have certain levels of command, and you draw chits from a cup, and that will tell you to either carry out a special event or activate this particular formation. In this game, typically you're activating cores. If you played the Civil War games, you typically roll a dice to see what kind of activation you're going to get, like a full activation or really a blunder. I wish that was present in this game. Yeah. I missed it. That's not here. If you pull 8th core, you're activating 8th core.
Yeah. But on this one, you don't roll a die, but you decide what posture your guy's going to take. So you can be aggressive, which is going to let you do more things like assault, or you can be defensive, which lets you move better, gives you a better command radius, lets you rebuild guys, stuff like that. So you do get to pick that, but you don't get to roll for any sort of activation.
Yeah, and so you activate those guys. This is you fire and then move, so you need to be within range, meaning it's potentially disastrous for you just to get into range. The range here is shorter, or like more, you need to be closer than in the Civil War games, just because I think the scale is different, right? So
yeah.
So typically, especially for the Prussians, you need to be right next to them. And
well,
then artillery
definitely for rifle fire,
right.
For cannon fire. It depends on whether you're Prussians or French, but the French are good for maybe 4 hexes and the Prussians are 6 or something like that.
So you have this fire phase, then you move, and then you can have an assault phase and try to, you know, overrun a hex and attack everyone adjacent into that. Of course, true to Blind Swords, there's going to be opportunity to counter fire. Here it's if they move adjacent. And then there's also opportunity fire chits, like you can fire again by playing one of your special command chits you've drawn. And one thing I'll touch on here, since I've kind of talked about it, is those special event chits. Maybe one lets you fire another artillery or get a column shift. There's actually a good spread here. I like that there's a lot of diversity in the special command chits. They're double-sided. And so anytime you draw a special command chit in this game, depending on the scenario you're playing, you can commit that command chit to the scenario-specific uses. That may mean getting your commander-in-chief or having a chance to get your commander-in-chief chit, which lets you activate any formation you want. That may mean speeding up the arrival of the very much needed Prussian reinforcements. And I really like that. I like this kind of dual use. You can take it for the special event, or you can commit it to these scenario-specific things for chances to do other things. I really like that.
Yeah. And you get a fair number of them, depending on the scenario and the time in the scenario. Most of the time, you're going to get 5 of those. So, you know, there's going to be a decent number of those random event chits are going to come out. And then when you save them, basically there's often a couple things you can save them for, but you can save like up to 3 for that sort of special thing. And every additional one you save gets you a better chance of getting that thing with a future die roll.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of just like other comparisons back to and I just had one, but it completely escaped me, which is not useful to anyone. Let's talk about just combat resolution. The Civil War games use a D66 system,
mm-hmm.
and then you roll their subsequent rolls to see the effect on units.
Yep.
Here, you roll a colored dice, you roll a white dice, you roll it. The white dice is the result of, like, the morale test. So the firer is already rolling for the defender, which I'm never a fan of.
Right. So
and
that's,
I just,
yeah, when you do fire combat, you do it that
right.
way.
Yep. Yeah, right. I don't like the fire combat here quite as much as I do in the Civil War stuff.
Yeah, I think it's just supposed to speed it up. I mean, you rolled both dice at the same time, and
right.
and the colored die, depending on where you are in the CRT, will basically change the number of the white die. So you rolled a 5, but it becomes an 8 or something like that. So if you're doing a morale test, +3. And then
right.
for assault combat, you only roll one die, and it affects both sides depending on where you roll on the table.
Let's see, what other, I guess, mechanics are present. Yeah, artillery fire, rifle fire, assaults.
Yeah, some of the chits do cool things too, and it's all modeling the specifics of the battle and the forces at that time. The Prussian guys were very aggressive, and the French can have a chit that forces the Prussians to be over aggressive. You can pull chits that let you move the other guys around, like Matt said, give you, you know, extra fire, combat, stuff like that. So there's lots of good nasty things that you can do with the chits that make the game a lot of fun.
There's a decent range of scenarios present. I played both the Mars Latour single day scenario, and then I re-racked and shifted to the Mars Latour campaign just for like the extended approach. I did not play the other campaign.
Yeah, I did that one for the first time. I've owned this game basically since it came out. I've played it a bunch of times. That was the first time I played that scenario though, which was interesting. I mean, really all it is, it's just sort of it's a what if on the day before the other campaign starts. And really it would be boring as hell to play it two player. I did it because I was playing solitaire, because it's really just bringing the French forces onto the map. The Prussians, the entire game, all they get is one cav corps that's basically just trying to defend Mars Latour, and they can do a good job with it. But the French are just slowly coming onto the map, trying to get everybody out of Metz. And it would be super boring for one of the players if you played it two player. I would recommend if you're playing against someone, just play that second campaign scenario, the one that starts on the next day.
Nice. I think there's a total of six scenarios, six with the one you just talked about.
Yeah. And some of them are relatively small, where you're basically just trying to fight over one or two different towns. You just bring your guys in and just very typical war game scenario. You're trying to move the forces up and gain some particular ground.
One thing I do want to talk about that's different here, or at least it hasn't been in the Civil War games I played in Blind Series or Blind Swords, the victory conditions. So in most of the Civil War stuff, it's occupy and hold this hex, and every turn you're occupying it, you're accumulating victory points. Here, the Prussians are just trying to eliminate French units. The French units have day by day victory conditions
that they can usually select secretly.
Yes. And that may be fight and kill the Prussians. That may be escape in this direction, escape in this direction. I think that's fun. It's harder to do that solo, which all my plays were solo. Sure. But I like this. The French can commit, and it maybe it's give battle where you're trying to inflict Prussian losses. But you could do this feint, right? Like you could start to pull off the battlefield and then hope to catch the Prussians off guard. Or just, go right at them. And that kind of changes how in the Mars Latour stuff, the French don't start with any activations. At the end of every turn, they're adding a core to the cup to add, like, okay, now you're activating two cores, three cores. Then you're deciding that. And so your victory conditions for that turn are obviously going to drive who you activate. Are you going to activate this one to get them off the map as soon as possible? Are you going to activate this one who's right by those calves at the start of the map so you can try to knock them off and pick up some victory points?
Yeah. Yeah, and the Prussians have a chit that lets you basically negate a future Prussian activation or a French activation. So you can even, I see what you're trying to do. Well, guess what? He's not going to activate this turn. He's not getting away from me.
It's really fun.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, I think it's interesting. I love the mitrailleuse, which is the very early machine gun, just because it's such a cool historical oddity to put that in the game. They stack with the cannons, but they don't use artillery fire. They use infantry fire type, even though they have to stack with the cannons. It's just cool. I like it. The map is beautiful. I love it.
Gorgeous map. Yep. Lots of good... The historical flavor, it comes in through those victory conditions, through the special events, through having the machine. Like, it's obviously very much there.
Yeah.
But
not just the look of the map either, but the terrain is interesting, especially that one, the area around some of those ravines around the towns are an interesting puzzle to try to get your cav and your artillery across. It's easier for the infantry, but you need the cav and the cannons to cross as well. So lots of puzzles for movement, which I like.
It's very easy to gum things up.
Oh, yeah.
which I found interesting because the terrain is very forgivable here in terms of line of sight, which there's a comment, right? This was like soft sloping hills. Mm-hmm. And when we're playing a greater, or no, the scenario was called a greater victory. We're playing the South Mountain Blind Swords, which I'm forgetting the name of. That terrain is brutal. And it's sharp, and there's all kinds of stuff. And
yeah,
here,
the
Ridge
one is like that too. You can't say anything on that map.
You got woods all over the place. Yep. Here, you as long as there's not something in front of you, like woods or a town, terrain doesn't really affect line of sight. Like it's soft enough slopes, and so that was a change of pace because my two other blind swords, P Ridge and South Mountain, have had brutal terrain, and this has been much easier to at least fire around. But you do have to like. Be very mindful of how you the order you move your troops and where people stop.
Yeah, I think it would be interesting, like if Herman Lutman was on or whatever, to ask him, is the CRT, is it different because you wanted to do something different for this battle, or did you evolve your game mechanics and then stuck with them over the Civil War stuff? You know what I mean? Because I think this was maybe the first Blind Swords game, or definitely one of the first.
It was not the first.
Okay.
The first was Stonewall Swords, I believe.
Oh, okay. Okay. The U.S. Civil War ones do have a different feel to them, and a lot of it is because of the dice and the CRT.
I agree. And the uncertainty of your actions, which is a big thing missing from here.
Yeah.
A Greater Victory is the game.
Okay.
I am looking up the scale of that because I wonder if it's also a scale thing.
Could be.
Do things fire different because of the scale?
Yeah.
Also, nothing dies here.
Yeah, it is hard to kill stuff. I mean, it's actually literally impossible to completely kill it, but even taking it off the map is hard. Yeah. If you manage to kill something, well, if you manage to take it off the map, it goes into a units eliminated this turn. Next turn, it goes for units available to rebuild. So nothing is permanently dead. It's hard to remove stuff. But you can hold your ground, which is nice. Because on that first day campaign that I played, I literally had like 3 cav and a couple cannons and a headquarters, and they were able to hold Mars la Tour because it's hard to knock somebody out of a city. The Prussian artillery is amazing, and you know, the Prussian cav had like 7 or 8 morale. And if you're rolling on a D10, you start putting -1/-2s on them. It hurts them, but they're still able to rally and come back. So, yep.
Just a quick follow-up. I did check. 500 yards a hex here, 150 yards a hex in a greater victory.
Oh, yeah, big difference.
So, yeah. I don't have major complaints. I touched on the two, kind of 3 big ones maybe.
Yeah, there's nothing I don't like about this game. I don't know. I've like I said, I got this game when it first came out. I've had it for a while. I play it probably not once a year, but it's been out, 5 years now? I mean, I'm sure I have 10 plays of it, so, you know, but I'll play it a couple times in a row, put it away for a while. I know I've taken this game day. I've played this in person a few times. I just like the game. I mean, it's one of those games that's like, it doesn't blow me away with anything, but it's just consistently good on everything. It's just always fun to play.
I could see that. I think it's a very solid all-around game.
Yeah.
It's not like... Now, if this was my first Blind Swords, I'd be like, whoa, check this out.
I mean, another good thing about it, it does have some long scenarios on it, obviously, but it's a one-mapper, and the short scenarios are fun battles to play. So
yeah,
it's definitely something you can play on a game day.
And here's the other thing, and this is just reality, right? There are people, understandably so, that never want to touch a U.S. Civil War game. So here's a great way to try out the system without, like, if you're not into that. Or if you're like, well, I already have 10 Gettysburgs game. Why do I need another one?
Yeah.
Well, here you go. Here's a Franco-Prussian war game that, you know, what else is out there?
Yeah. Nothing I can think of.
Yeah, no, there's not much, and probably not.
If you want dollar store Napoleon, this is the way to go.
Yeah, right. Hey, we finally played a Napoleonics game.
Yeah, absolutely. It's the wrong Napoleon, but sure.
Recommended reading. I really like the Wawro book. It's recent. I think it's like a 2010s publication. That's the Franco-Prussian War, Geoffrey Wawro. Did you read anything for this?
I did not. In the notes, it recommends a book. I think it's called The Day of Battle. I looked for that at the bookstore, and I couldn't find it. I didn't order it online, but that one's recommended, but I haven't read it, so I can't say if it's good or not.
Yeah, that's A Day of Battle by David Ascoli. The other book I considered, I think, was this Michael Howard, The Franco-Prussian War book. I think that was one of the ones I had considered, but Herman Lettman has a great article on GMT's website. In the playbook, there's a great write-up on the...
Yeah, the playbook itself is excellent reading. I mean, five, six pages at least in there? It's good stuff.
There's a good chunk. And there's also, what I really liked about it is you have these five or six pages, whatever, and then you have all these little breakout boxes. It's like, here's kind of like how it applies to the game, or here's an interesting aside. All right. You know what time it is.
Time to play a war game?
No, not. But it's time for the list.
What list?
Folks, we have a list.
I've never heard of this.
A list of every war game ever made. Appropriately named Every War Game Ever list. And if you're just finding our episode, here's how it works. We take a game at any cost Metz, and we rank it against every other war game ever made that we've covered so far. But the kicker is, it's completely objective. Rich and I put on blindfolds, we start the clay wheel, and we just stick out our hands and see what shape the list takes. And that's what we're doing tonight with At Any Cost Met. So we have 64 games on the list so far. US of War at the top, Zeppelin Raider at the bottom. I'm going to tell you it's going to go somewhere in between those two.
There we go.
All right, I think where we need to start is Thunder in the Ozarks.
Yeah, that was the obvious place because is that the only blind swords game we have on here?
So far, yep.
Yeah.
I would probably put this below just because I like the Civil War stuff more, like just topically, right?
Yeah, totally fair.
But not too far below.
I agree with that, yeah.
I would put it above Battle Hymn.
Yeah, like I said, and we'll get back to this, but I mean, Battle Hymn, the further I get away from it, the less I'm enamored with it just because... Mm-hmm. I think Blind Swords has just kind of kicked Battle Hymn off of my radar, you know?
Yeah, it really has.
It's totally fair because even though this isn't a Civil War game, it is a Blind Swords game. Yeah, above Battle Hymn, I could see that.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of my next inclination.
Here we go, though. So right above Battle Hymn is Atlantic Chase, which, going back to what I said a couple minutes about this, is this game. There's nothing wrong with it at all. I don't have any negative thing to say about it, but it doesn't blow me away either. Atlantic Chase, I think, has that sort of it factor because it's so different. So yep. I would put Atlantic Chase above this one.
Yeah, I agree. I think we have our slot. That's got to be like the fastest ranking ever.
There we go.
Nice. 21. So coming in at 21st, At Any Cost Metz, 1870. But folks, do not go away because we have another game to talk about.
If you hate the non-wargaming stuff, stick around a little longer.
Yeah, right. This comes from Kevin. So this is a patron pick from Kevin, one of our patrons. He wanted to hear us talk about the 1986 classic from the wargaming powerhouse design team at Milton Bradley. That's right. It's Fortress America.
It's a CSR winner.
It is. 1986 CSR winner designed by Michael Gray. This setting wise, it's
this is like drug fueled at this point. What if the entire rest of the world invades the United States?
Right. Have you seen Red Dawn? Because that's the setting.
Times three.
But what is interesting in this game?
The Mexicans are invading, the Chinese are invading.
Now, Rich, it's obviously been a while since you've watched Red Dawn because both the Cubans and Russians invade in Red Dawn. Here you have obviously the Russians that aren't the Russians. You have the Asia sphere and you have the South America sphere invade the United States. And what's interesting, where they work together in Red Dawn, the 1984 cult classic, they do not work together here. They work together, but they can not work together in this game.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, and so, they cannot fight against each other, but they can also like block each other from supply lines and stuff like that.
And you could play this two-player. You could play this three-player, four-player, whatever. You can divide up those. So I played this solo, and then I also played a three-player game of it, which was, I will give it credit, the third player just dropped in as we started, and I was like, okay, here's how you play. It's very light.
There's it's not a whole lot of strategy and thinking.
No. So this is one player playing the U.S. while they get invaded from the West, the East, and the South. And it's, gosh, I don't know. There's three types of different units, and they inflict. What is cool is, like, infantry rolls one type of die, and yeah, the hover tanks roll a different type of die.
And not only do they roll a different kind of die, but they also, you have to do the opposing losses based on who took the shot, as long as, you know, like, infantry can't just, like, decide to take out the bombers first or whatever.
Right. And so it's kind, and like, you do have bombers and helicopters, and then the U.S. gets partisans that pop up
and lasers.
And then here's, yeah, I was gonna say, and here's where it jumps the shark, lasers every turn.
They can shoot anywhere.
Yeah, and they just, so like, you obviously want to put your first laser in Kansas City because it's gonna be hard to get to Kansas City. There's like resource locations that don't really matter. They kind of matter for points at the end. Right, and then they matter for the partisan cards. So, like, partisans will pop up if the Russians leave spots ungarrisoned. And what's interesting, or I say Russians, I'm going to keep doing that.
Enemies.
There's three different people, whatever, you get what I'm talking about.
If invaders, I get
invaders, that's better. The invaders never get reinforcements. And so their opening wave is their attack force.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of, like, this is a super light game. 12-year-old me, the first time I saw Red Dawn, whenever that was, would have loved this shit.
Okay, so I'm glad you said that, because in 1986, I was 13 years old. And my thought when I was playing with this is my 13-year-old self would have absolutely loved this game.
Yeah, yeah. That's.
And I never played this when I was a kid. I played Axis and Allies all the time, but I never played this one.
Now, this is, I've never played Axis and Allies. This is above Axis and Allies in terms of, like, difficulty, not difficulty, but just, like, depth, right, with the different forces and stuff?
I don't know. I'd put Axis and Allies higher. Because Axis and Allies, you actually, you get to spend production to buy new units as you see fit.
Oh, okay.
And then you can lose factories, which means you'll lose production. And yeah, there's definitely more to Axis and Allies than there is in this one.
Okay. Yeah, so, but this is like the bad guys, invaders, they storm on, and then really it's a, can they knock America out before America starts building up its strength,
mm-hmm.
getting more and more reinforcements, and getting more and more lasers coming online.
The lasers always just cracks me up, because the lasers can literally, like, you can have one in Minnesota and it can shoot into Mexico. It doesn't matter.
Oh yeah. Did you play this on Vassal by any chance?
Yeah, that's the only way I could play it. I wish I could play this on the table, because I think it'd be even more fun with the little plastic minis.
Oh, you know it would be.
Yeah.
But did you play with your sound on?
No.
Oh, so every time you fire a laser on the Vassal module, it makes an amazing laser sound.
I didn't
sound.
Even notice that. Yeah. That's hilarious.
It's pretty bad in the grand scheme of things.
I mean,
like, it's super awesome, but it's not atrocious either.
It is what it is. It's
right.
Not trying to be. It's
right.
Not trying. It does not take itself seriously. It's just a goofy little fun game.
Yeah. I do like that it could play four players. I would never track down a copy of this. But
yeah.
If someone
and
did, like,
actually,
at a con.
Wasn't there a new release in, like, 2012 or something like that?
Yeah, I don't think it's very good. There's a Fantasy Flight version.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's right. But the funny, I don't remember ever seeing this in a store. Like,
oh, no.
Even, I mean, if it's Fantasy Flight, you think Miniature Market would have it on the shelf, but I don't think they do.
Yeah, 2012. Yeah, I never saw this. In 2012, I was going to Tabletop at their old location a decent amount. I don't recall seeing this.
I mean, if I was at Goodwill and I found this thing for $5 or $10, I'd get it.
Okay, I agree with you. Just to have it.
Yeah.
And it would be fun if, like, my kids ever had an interest in playing war games. This would probably be pretty awesome. it is beyond, you know, a step above risk, that type of thing.
Yep. Yeah, I would put it like, yeah, that's a good, it's between risk and access and allies.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the U.S. kind of takes it in the teeth, but what did happen in like our three-player game is, I think you really have to consolidate as the invaders, because it was not long before America was roaring back and destroying everything.
Yeah. And I laugh about the lasers, but I mean, they're super effective, because you can use them anywhere you want to. On, you just roll a die. I don't remember what the die roll is, but they're probably going to destroy a unit every turn.
I guess there are some like strategy decisions to be made too, because it's like when you lose a city, you get a new partisan card. So
yeah,
which it just gives America. So if you take a city, you're helping America build back. I don't know. Fortress America. You have anything to say about it other than that?
No, I mean, I've said what I need to say. 13-year-old me would have loved it. It's not as good as Axis and Allies, and I would pay $5 or $10 for it. I think that's a good summary.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. So here's the deal. I think people who did play this in 1986 or early 90s or whenever they played it, when they played it at a younger age, or I don't know, I think they have nostalgia for it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard to get that nostalgia now. Like, I can see why people loved it and ate this up.
Yeah.
But, okay.
It's nostalgia. Yeah. Which is another reason they re-released it in 2012. I mean, it's like, and this is another one I haven't played, but when they re-released Dark Tower a few years ago, everybody bought it, but I don't think it's, from what I've heard, it's not a great game. It's just nostalgia. It looks cool on the table.
Yeah, and this will look cool on the table.
Yeah.
Recommended reading, you just watch Red Dawn.
Yeah, there you go.
That's all you do. The original, please.
Wolverines.
Please do not watch the remake.
Oh, man. Talk about when you were a kid, movies that messed you up, when they had to shoot their friend.
Oh my gosh.
Because he had the Russian bug in his stomach. Man, yeah. That's hard for a kid to watch.
When, you know, when they pop out of the field and they're like, they had like the grass coverings over the.
Oh yeah.
So we found some like corrugated tin out in this field, and I'm not making this up. And I had recently watched Wolverines.
Yeah.
And I tried to make like a booby trap thing, like with like putting grass on that tin, and tried to make my own little pop out hole when they like are running through the fields and they pop out and mow down the Russians.
Nice.
Not nearly as cool or effective, and probably didn't get that far in the project. All right, let's rank it.
Goes on the list.
Kevin, it's thank you very Zeppelin much Raider. For a great pick. It is better than Zeppelin Raider. Okay, here's where it really probably goes for me is, you did play Titan, right?
Yes. And okay. That's about where, I think we're in the same area.
Yeah. Titan is such an interesting concept where breaking out into this arena is really cool.
And that's a fascinating comparison. Titan tries hard and fails. This game does not try at all. And maybe succeeds. I don't know.
Oh. If I was playing two player and someone said, do you want, I don't know. Like, also it depends. Like, if I, this plays so fast.
If someone gave me the choice of this game or Titan, I'd take Fortress America.
Okay. What about Ottoman Sunset?
That's a solitaire game. So that's, yeah. Do you want to play a solitaire game or do you want to play Fortress America? I think I'd probably play Ottoman Sunset.
There it is. All right. Number 63. I'm not going to argue too much between Titan and Fortress America. I think your analysis is very appropriate. Titan tries very hard and Fortress America doesn't. And Fortress America pulls it off.
Yeah.
I mean, this is, in terms of fun, like everything else we just talked about last week. But also Fortress Ottoman Sunset's a lot of fun too. So
yeah, it is. I mean, I played it, I don't know, a dozen times or so, and it just sort of lost its luster for me because I played it too many times, but I enjoyed it while I was playing it.
Fortress America is the fortress of the bottom of the list. Because after Fortress America, there is a very big drop off with the last three. Kevin, thank you so much for the excellent recommendation. And that's as good a time as any to plug our Patreon. But before we do that, I'll give a shout out to the featured patron this month, and that's Hector Reyes. Hector, thanks for being a patron. Hector is who I played the, speaking of Atlantic Chase earlier, the campaign of Atlantic Chase, which we desperately need to get back to and was excellent. So Kevin supported the show. He got to pick a game that we feature. He did that by going to patreon.com/historytable, becoming a patron. You can do the same thing if you want to support the show, and you get to vote on each month's game. Each month has an asterisk. Sometimes we'll use host fiat and decide what we want to play, but you'll have your choice between like 5, 6, 7, 8 games, whatever we come up with. But two of them we're going to talk about right now. I'll start. I'm going to put forward Desert Victory, North Africa, 1940 to 1942. This is the C3I game that just came out that I know we both have.
Oh, yeah, excellent. I knew I'd seen it somewhere, but I couldn't remember where. Yeah.
Yeah, this is Trevor Bender's follow-up to the Kursk game that came out that was very well regarded. I wanted to play the Kursk game, but never got a chance to. And so, yeah, this. Other than that, I actually don't know much about this game other than I want to play it.
Yeah, sounds good. I, as you can tell my, from my reading, I'm on an Ancients kick, so I wanted to play something Ancients. I actually thought about just saying any Ancients game at all, but that didn't seem like it was fair. And then I thought, well, I really want to play SPQR, but that's already on the list. So, I'm going to put Successors on there because okay. That is a fun little game that I have played on the table before with a group of people. It's sort of a negotiation game. It's maybe borderline war game, but it's just a fun game that is not very heavy, but it's fun to play. And I thought that'd be interesting to see where that would show up on the list.
Awesome. I like it. I will say that if you do want more great battles of history, Julius Caesar is also an option, but I like
the
Successors.
Yeah, I really, I was eyeing that at Miniature Mark and I might pick that up this week.
Oh, very good.
Yeah.
I assume you mean the 2022 fourth edition.
You talking about Successors?
Uh-huh.
You know, I'm not sure what the differences are. I don't have the new version.
Okay.
I'm not sure which version I have, but I don't know.
The new version looks very shiny.
Yeah.
I like the original art or the third edition art way more.
Yeah. I can't remember which version I have, but I mean, we had fun when we played it. It was a good game day game.
Sweet. Okay. So that poll will be up for, I'll try to time it. Last time the results were in before I got the episode out. I'll not make the same mistake then. I'll put the poll up as soon as the episode drops, and then you'll have a few days to go and vote and pick our game for March.
Excellent.
Okay, we have a listener question. Before we talk about our most
serious time in the show, when we get to our listener questions.
Ultra serious. This is, folks. All right, Art had a great one, and I'll clean up the language, but we're all familiar with the Mary Kill screw game. Clean up the language here a little bit. And Art had a good one. One that I like. It's a simple game, but I think the choices are interesting. I'm going to change my options a little bit. You can do the same, but Art said, Mary Screw or Kill, OCS, BCS, SCS. Operational Combat Series, Battalion Combat Series, Standard Combat Series. I've not played Standard Combat Series. I've read the rules to it. I'm going to swap in. I'm going to do another DNESIG, and I'm going to swap in Line of Battle. Just because I've played more Line of Battle.
I'm
going to
keep SCS in mind, so.
Okay, you want to go first or second?
Are we going to do them all at the same time, or how are we going to do it?
Okay, who would you marry? We'll just do it
One go. I would marry OCS.
Okay,
OCS
just because of the
depth? Yeah, depth, long run, nice lifelong commitment.
I would marry Line of Battle.
Interesting.
Just, again, because of the depth and like length of playing them all. Mm-hmm. The full battle scenarios, especially in Gettysburg and Antietam, are massive. And that would be a cool deal. So, sorry, Catherine. Hello, Line of Battle. All right. Who'd you screw?
Oh, BCS. BCS is the new sexy.
Yeah, I actually agree with you 100%. BCS. Which leaves... who we're killing off.
Yeah, interesting. So I would kill off SCS. I'm fine with never playing another SCS game. The only one that I've ever played that I actually enjoyed was Heights of Courage. I actually have the Cold War one, but I haven't played it yet. So, but for the most part, SCS just sort of leaves me flat.
Okay, I'm going to kill OCS.
Interesting.
Not for any knock on the... Look, go listen to Korea. I love OCS, but it's had its time in the sun. I recently purged some OCS titles. I know what I like in an OCS game. I'm not a big East Front guy, and like the last three titles have been East Front titles. And
now, isn't get over there it. Is a Finnish one coming out soon, though, isn't there?
That's not... That's how dare you. That's different. I'll kill it after. And that's, I think that's a ways off, but I'll kill it after the Finland game comes out. Yeah. You know what? It's just like OCS is great. It's old tried and true, mm-hmm. but I'm going to step out on it and try a little BCS. So that's why that's that choice. And then Line of Battle's one of my favorite series that I desperately need to get back to.
Nice. Thank you, Art. Fun. I love it.
Yeah, great question, Art. We should do that yeah, with other
everyone,
related things.
We really do love these off-the-wall questions. Keep them coming.
Yeah, we had a good amount of them. I only picked one just because I know we still have more to talk about.
Yeah.
Okay. Folks, we do this every year. We do our most anticipated games of the year. And, Rich, you sent me a message a few days ago, and you said, and I'm paraphrasing, that you didn't know if there's anything you're looking forward to this year.
Yeah. I mean, I was having a hard time coming up with six. The one that's going to end up being my number one was super obvious for me, but the rest of them, I was like, what's coming out this year? There's nothing that I'm really thinking about too much. And then I started just looking at I've started visiting like the publisher's websites and looked at BGG a little bit like, oh yeah, there's some stuff out here that was not necessarily right at the front of my radar, but things that I was looking forward to. Yeah. So I ended back. Up, I think I like came back a good day after that. I said, okay, I've got it Darum down to 13 now. So
I sent you back out there because when I look at 2023 and I looked, you're going to hear some repeats last year. I really tried to make my list on things that I was more or less certain were coming out this year. So there's going to be some repeats and stuff. And I cut off things that I was uncertain of. With that being said, I had a hard time narrowing it down to six. I think 2023 is going to be an absolute fantastic year for historical games. There's good stuff from every publisher on the radar, and I'm looking at Rich's options he's got now, and I'm mad that I completely forgot one of them, even though I have it on pre-order.
Yeah, and you have one we'll talk about that I'm not sure that one's coming out this year, so it didn't make my list, but let's jump into it.
Okay, here we go. Number six. So I went with the Mark Simonich title. It's not Zoc Bond exactly, but it's Zoc Bond adjacent, and that's North Africa 41. That's Mark Simonich going to World War II North Africa. Yeah. I'm super excited for it.
Cool. Yeah, for me, number six, and this is funny because I always make fun of you for putting it on here, but maybe Battle Hymn Volume 2 is going to come out this year. And,
sure.
And like Rich. I've said, I've even said it earlier this episode, the further I get away from Battle Hymn, the less enamored I am with it. But if Battle Hymn Shiloh comes out, I'm going to be all over it. So we'll see.
So here's, I made a tweet before we recorded.
They say it's coming out this year, but they have said that for, what, 3 years now?
Yeah. Has anyone actually talked to Eric Lee Smith? Because one time they said it was coming out, and Eric Lee Smith was like, I have no idea what they're talking about. I did not feel the need to throw in Battle Hymn without confidence this year because there's so much good stuff coming out.
Yeah.
All right.
I looked over my list, though, and if it comes out this year, it deserves to be on my list, but that's a big if.
Fair. Number five, Plantagenet.
Yeah, so actually, this is the one. Is that one coming out this year? Because I didn't think it was.
Yeah, so I just did a double check.
Okay.
And that is going to the printer later this month.
Okay, excellent. So that one probably should have made my list. That probably should have been my sixth then, but that's good.
Yep.
That's
this is one of,
I've got a P500 it, so.
Yeah, this is one of the Levian campaign games I'm looking forward to the most, Plantagenet. There is a Henry game, but like Henry is a very small Levian campaign game. Not as excited about that one. So yeah, Plantagenet should be awesome.
Yeah, so next one on my list is a game by Histogame. It's called Triumph Amarengo. And you've talked about this one. I'm sure this is one that you forgot about or whatever, because this one looks really interesting to me. It's got the, the bars, like in that game that we played with, the Gettysburg game I played with Don, or like in, I don't know. It looks like an interesting game. It's a Napoleonic game, and just looks really interesting to me. So when that comes out, that would be at the top of my list to take a second look at.
Yeah, props to HistoGame. They've changed different sources for their components with everything that's been going on in Ukraine and countries that back Russia. So I know that was probably a sting to their finances to
Yeah.
delay this. Also worth noting, at least as far as HistoGame indicates, probably the last board game we'll see from Bowen Simmons. And there's a lot of like Napoleon's Triumph and just a lot of games from Bowen Simmons that I want to own and I don't own. The only game I own is Guns of Gettysburg, which I desperately want to play. So I'm mad that I completely forgot about this one because it was in my mind, it's a 2022 release, even though obviously we didn't get it. This would probably be number two if I hadn't forgotten it. All right. Number four. You have coming up later, so I'll just save it, which I know we don't normally do, but we're going to talk about it at the same time. So you go ahead.
That's fine. My number four is Purple Haze by Phalanx Games.
Yeah.
This one looks really interesting to me. It's a Vietnam game. It looks like it's got some storytelling elements, maybe like a little bit of a campaign thing in there. Kind of from the description I've read, it kind of looks like an updated version of the old Ambush game. So that one looks interesting to me.
Very good. Yeah, I'm going to keep a close eye on that one. I read in their February update they're doing something with Tunnel Rats. I read this Tunnel Rats book that my grandpa recommended a few years ago, and it was what those guys did was insane. And so having that present in the game was very interesting. So I'm keeping a close eye on that. I did not back it on GameFound or anything like that.
Yeah.
All right, number three. I think this is on my list last year. This is Prelude to Revolution. This is coming out from Compass anytime. I know it's coming out because they just did their Kickstarter, their like 4-day Kickstarter where they try to get more sales. Yeah, this covers the Russian Revolution, kind of the build up to it. There's all these different tracks you're manipulating cubes. We've heard our buddy Don talk about this a number of times. I've looked forward to it since I saw a video, I think, from Ardwolf back at a Compass Expo where he first saw this. Really looking forward to this one. Which is rare. I'm kind of hesitant on Compass sometimes, but this one
Sure,
still
yeah.
looking forward to.
Three for me is Grand Herrick Havoc Perryville, which is
Nice.
a blind swords game. If it, you know, may not have heard of the game, but there's going to be a blind swords Perryville game coming out, and anything blind swords is going to be on my radar. So I'm looking forward to seeing that.
Yeah, I also, just as a side note, I think we have real Napoleonic's Blind Swords potentially coming out this year as well. I don't know if it's
Nice,
2023,
interesting.
but they talked about that. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be moving blind swords back, 50 years, so be interesting to see. Not that that
Sure.
surprises me, but they've been in a pretty narrow time period so far.
Yeah, absolutely. My number two is later on your list. Let's talk about my earlier number four and your number two.
Sure.
It's Border Reavers.
Border Reavers, yeah. Which, I mean, for me, honestly, it's a new Ed Beach game, so it's definitely on the radar. Looks interesting. I don't. It's hard to say what. I haven't seen like any videos on it or anything. I've just read the description on it, but I'm not sure. So the immediate comparison is going to be Here I Stand, and I'm sure there's going to be at least a little bit of that in there, but I think it's going to be pretty different from that as well. So I'm just looking forward to seeing what he's going to come out with, and if unless something weird happens, this will be one that I pick up.
Yeah, this is so it's three Scottish clans, three English clans. I don't know if it's 1 to 6 players, but it's up to 6 players. I don't know if it has solo mode. And you're trying to make your clan the most influential. And so it's multiplayer Ed Beach. Yeah, no brainer for me.
Yep.
All right, my number one. Finally, we are getting Winner's Victory from New England Simulations. This was supposed to be their 2022 release, but they put a bunch of work into their games. And the only time I go to Consum World forums is to check on the status of Winner's Victory. And I know that they were putting a lot of work to make sure this was a final product. So this is Napoleonic's game, and it seems to, from what I've seen, have some similarities to GCACW. It has beautiful looking map and components and kind of like just like displays for tracking your units. That will come out in June or July, and I cannot wait for this game.
Yeah, New England Simulations is great, and I'm sure it's going to be wonderful. I don't know that I'll pick this one up, but we'll see. I can be talked into it.
Sure. All right, number one.
Yeah, number one.
Your number one,
my
number two.
Which was two on your list is On to Richmond 2. So this is Great Campaigns in the American Civil War. This is another one of their, kind of like Road to Gettysburg 2, where they deluxified and combined some older modules, and it's all coming out together. There's going to be new maps. It's going to be updated everything. And I mean, I fully expect this one to be kind of like Pacific War was for me last year, where when I get it, it's going to stay on my table for a long time.
Yeah, I've got a series of books, the Rhea books, lined up, ready to go as soon as this thing is closer on the horizon.
Nice.
This was on my list last year, but now we have confirmation that this will be a 2023 release from MMP.
Yep.
Cannot wait. Yeah, it's the top two for me, and then really if you throw Triumph of Marengo on there, those three are like clear, no-brainers, cannot wait. Everything falling in behind it. Plantagenet, I'm really excited for as well. Mm-hmm. But those three are like, holy smokes, can't wait.
Yeah.
Sweet. I did not put this on the list, and so chew on this, and I'll follow up back with you. Talking about Border Reavers,
mm-hmm.
harkens back to a conversation that came up in the Dads on a Map Discord server, which was, are there any series or games out there that are by sight unseen? And I followed up with, it used to be GCACW. Hood Strikes North kind of, it didn't sour me on the series by any means, but it made me realize I don't have to own every GCACW game.
Yeah.
Obviously, I still love GCACW. I'm getting on to Richmond too, yada, yada, yada. So then I think that just left multiplayer Ed Beach games, which Ed Beach also did work on GCACW. So, like, is it in? I don't think he's involved with Hood Strikes North. So, is it just Ed Beach games are by sight unseen for me?
Because, I mean, Next War.
Okay. Now, I'll be honest, when Iran was very first announced,
yeah.
I was like, do I need Iran? But then, since learning more about that, I have, yes, obviously I want and need Iran, and I very much appreciate the fact that Mitch has said an important thing to do when you're doing a series like this is to keep adding innovation.
Right.
So you're not just doing the same thing over and over again. So I know and have read about the changes in Iran and the fact that you have the Allies on the offensive. We've talked about it. That's super interesting. But that wasn't sight unseen. I pre-ordered Border Reavers the second it was announced without reading any of the details.
Yeah, interesting.
So do you have, other than Next War, do you have any others?
I'm not sure I do, because even my favorites, you know, BCS, sure. I don't know. It seems like a lot of these big series, and they're really ramping up their production. They're producing more things faster. So how many things are in the BCS queue right now? How many things are OCS queue? Even ASL, which used to be like, if something comes up, you have to get it. Otherwise, you won't see it again for 5 or 10 years or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
ASL's got so much stuff coming out now that I would love to have it all, but I just can't. So even like new historical modules that are like, yeah, that looks really cool, but I can't get everything. So I'm getting further and further away from having to have everything. But like you said, a multiplayer Ed Beach game, it's not like he's just cranking out stuff in a series. That's going to be something new from a proven guy. So I can see why that you would say, yeah, I'm buying it.
Yeah. And I think your response is there's not a right answer here. People are going to buy what they want to buy. I think that's, broadly speaking, the best response. I think where we are in the hobby, just in the general physical gaming hobby, whether you're talking about Magic or board games or war games, doesn't really matter. With so much stuff coming out and so much stuff demanding your attention, you're absolutely right. But I did think it was like an interesting exercise, because my first answer, my gut answer was, no, that's ridiculous. I'm going to wait. I've been burned too many times before. Sure. But then it's like, well, damn, GCACW is pretty damn close. Line of battle depends on the topic.
Yeah.
OCS depends on the topic. BCS, you know, I go down the list. It mm-hmm. all depends on the topic. Simonich is close, but I didn't get successors. You know, so like even everything Mark Simonich works on.
Right.
Real close, but not everything.
Yeah. And I'm not 100% sure I'll get North Africa 41. I'll keep an eye on it. We'll see. But we'll see.
Anyways, I just thought that was a fun topic, and you know, apply that to war games and if any of those coming out.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Cool. All right, folks. We have one other war game related topic, and then you can keep listening for all the other nonsense or turn the podcast off. You do what you want to do. We have a couple other games we're going to talk about that we played, that type of thing. So we had a GMT monthly update. We had a Phalanx update. I don't want to run through them, but did you have anything pop out from those that you're like, oh, look at that, I need to get that?
No, when the GMT update came out, you know, the first thing I always do is look at what the new P500s are. So, I mean, sure. The first thing I clicked on was order and opportunity, and then I read the description. Uh-huh. I'm like, oh, no, that's all right.
Yeah.
It just didn't look that interesting to me. I mean, it's kind of a Cold War game. It could turn out to be an interesting negotiation game, but yep, it didn't jump out at me as something I was going to jump on.
I'm going to keep a very close eye on it. I'm very much enjoying my plays of All Bridges Burning, and this is from VPJ Arpinen,
okay,
who is the designer behind that. So, typically not my cup of tea, something like this, but Flashpoint South China Sea also was the same thing, and that really surprised me. So, I'll keep a closer eye on this one. The Combat Commander, I thought that package was awesome, the like Master Edition.
Yeah,
I'm not going to get Combat Commander. I just thought that was a cool...
There's a couple things coming up for Combat Commander, I think.
Yeah, yeah. There's two Combat Commander pack, P500s, yeah, and then the Order and Opportunity and the Mounted Map.
Yeah.
From the like teasers, the only thing that jumped out at me was there was a post-1970s operational game set in Europe. So my thought was post-1970s, you're not saying the 80s exclusively, but are you talking Cold War Goes Hot, or are you talking something like Bosnia? I wonder what they're teasing there. It could be something interesting.
Yeah.
And then
I'm not good at first guessing games, so.
Oh yeah. Well, no, I don't know if I've ever been right. But on the Phalanx side, nothing. They provided a bunch of updates on stuff. Have you played Tigris and Euphrates on BGA? I can't remember.
Yeah, I played it once and okay, it didn't click.
Okay.
I didn't hate it, but it just didn't really click.
So this won't apply to you, but there was a follow-up called Yellow and Yangtze, which is what I own. I don't have Tigris and Euphrates. I'd love to have it. It's a fantastic game that I like. Phalanx is doing a follow-up to that called... I don't remember what it's called. Huang? H-U-A-N-G is what it's called. And so it is basically Yellow and Yangtze with a few things added in, and that's a game related to Tigris and Euphrates, if you follow all that. I'm going to keep an eye on it. I own Yellow and Yangtze. I wish I owned Tigris and Euphrates. I don't know if this is going to scratch the same itch. I just thought it was interesting that they have, I don't know, that doesn't really necessarily jump out as a Phalanx title, but good for them. That's going on GameFound.
Sure.
Okay. We have some games to talk about. They're not war games. War game talk is more or less done, unless you want to talk about how Magic is war, but we'll get to that. I played Greenland. This is a Phil Eklund game where you're representing a tribe in Greenland and you go out and hunt and try to gather resources. What'd you think of this?
It was interesting. I actually looked for it at Miniature Market just because it's a small game and I thought the family would like it. They didn't have it. So, but I thought if I could find that for $20 or something, that'd probably be a good pickup for the family.
Yeah. I like this a lot. I think,
yeah, you destroyed us.
Yeah, I think we, again, had a very forgiving and generous opening, meaning we didn't have, like, we were able to hunt quite effectively. I do worry about, and this isn't that much of a concern for me most times, I do worry about the depth. Like, how many games does Greenland have inside of it? It
yeah,
feels like it's very fun, but I don't know how many times I would play it. It's very heavy on iconography, which...
Yeah.
Once you have it down, the icons all make sense, but it is a little bit... That's like the initial hurdle, is just getting all the icons knocked out.
That kind of just rewards playing it more, though.
Yeah. Yeah, I just... Like, once you see it pull its levers, I don't know, like... I keep going back. Am I going to get... Because my local game store does have a copy. I'm like...
Yeah. We were all basically learning the game, so... I could see... Yes, I agree that it might not be a game you want to play a dozen times, but I think after two or three times, I think it would probably really hit its stride and it'd be more fun.
Yeah, maybe. All right, we also played Kremlin, which was insanely fun.
Have you ever played that one before?
No, that was okay. My first play of it.
It's such a wild game.
And basically you influence individuals as they move through the Soviet Politburo, and they'll die, and they'll go away for a little bit, and they'll come back, and the people you least expect will be appointed to positions that become extremely important. Mm-hmm. And all you try to get to do is to get the top head honcho to wave at you three times, and that's how you win.
Yep.
This is amazing. It's so light. It's so fun. It's ridiculous.
It is as every bit as serious as Fortress America.
Yeah. I really like this. It's really so much fun.
Yeah. It was only the second time I played it, but both times I played it, we had an absolute blast.
It's so cutthroat too.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. So I wanted to just bring up Commander Magic again, because I know you had played before the lake, but then we played a few games at the lake.
Uh-huh.
What I just curious, like, obviously I love Commander. It's my favorite format for playing Magic. I try to play as often as I can. What did you think?
So it was definitely fun. Nothing against it at all. I will say that while it's fun trying out new decks, I think it's going to be more fun if you know what's in the deck. Because, like, literally every time I play Commander, it's the first time I've ever played that deck. And every time I pull another card, I'm like, oh, I didn't know I had this card. What does this do? So I think it gets to be more fun when you know your deck a little bit, but it was still a blast.
Yeah, plus there's, like, nuances, like, why is this deck even in this card?
Right.
Where if it's, like, a crazy, I don't know, jank strategy that's trying to do something very specific, and you're like, why is this?
Which I had one the one time you played, and you even, like, tried to explain it to me, like, yeah, you need to be doing this with that deck, so.
Oh, yeah. So, and another thing, I recently put together a Canadian Highlander deck to play with our buddy Matt. He's responsible for this. So, this is 100-card singleton format.
Okay.
You don't have a commander. It's more or less Brawl on Arena, but it doesn't have as strict a ban list, and you kind of have, like, okay, so if you take, like, the original Power 9, you can play with them, but you only have 10 points. And the, like, busted cards in Magic are assigned points. So XYZ card might be 7 of your 10 points if you really want to put in your deck. So 100 cards, 20 life, 1v1, which is nice. And I think we're going to try to knock some games out of that. Anyways, that's Canadian Highlander. Looking forward to playing that.
Cool.
All right. Have you been reading anything interesting?
Yeah, my wife and I started reading this book called Area X.
Okay.
Which I think that's the trilogy's name. I think the first book is called Annihilation.
Oh, this is the Annihilation series?
Yes,
I thought that was called something else.
What's that?
I thought this was called something else.
I think the name of the trilogy is Area X, and I think the first book is called Annihilation. So
Annihilation is the first book, and I love it.
Okay, I thought I'd heard about it from you, but I couldn't remember who I'd heard it from.
Yes.
So, yeah. Yeah, we're liking it so far. It's just weird and, you know, slightly creepy. And it's like, it's definitely got a Lost feel to it, the TV show. And yeah, it's good. I mean, we're enjoying it. It's got us, you know, on the edge of our seats trying to figure out what the hell's going on. And I like it.
Southern Reach is what that trilogy is called.
Okay. Got
the area is called Area X.
Yeah.
I love the atmosphere. And, like, are you getting, it's not explicitly Lovecraftian or Cthulhu horror, but, like, I get those vibes.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, I think, like I said, Lost is, like, the main thing that comes to mind. But, there's stuff going on that they can't explain, so.
Yep. Oh, so good.
Yeah.
Love it.
And
awesome. I'm glad you're
crazy, and this place drives people crazy, and every people are being lied to about what's really going on. So,
yes.
Yeah, it's all good stuff.
Very good. All right, anything else off the table you want to talk about?
No, I think that's it.
Awesome. All right.
How about you?
No. Reorganizing the game shelves.
Yeah.
Making sure everything fits. Primarily, my reading has been, I read some other, like, murder mystery thing. It was fine. I don't need to talk about it. And then that Prussian War, so, and then playing Magic. Matt and I got a spell table game in with some other people from another Discord server. That was a ton of fun. Yeah, just hanging out with the kids.
Nice.
Getting back to working out and all that kind of stuff, and yeah.
Yeah. I think I'm going to get to play Twilight Imperium next month, so I'm looking forward to that.
Hey, good.
Yeah.
Very good. I think that's going to go in the purge pile for me.
Yeah. I mean, it's a bear, and it's hard to get people to commit to it, but I love it.
Yeah. And I know some people that have a copy.
Right.
But
sure.
Since getting the new edition, I've not played it, so.
Yeah. I get it.
Yep. I would love to, but it takes up a lot of space.
Sure does. Yeah, even more so. I mean, the with the expansion, you can play up to 8 players, which I can't even imagine that. I mean, 6, I love playing with 6. I don't know that I want to add 2 players to that mix.
Yeah. Sweet. Well, that's going to do it for us, folks. Again, thank you I kind of lost how we normally close, but I'm picking it back up. If you want to hang out with us, you can join our Discord. There's a link down in the show notes, or you can, some people have sent a message and said, hey, how do we get on the Discord? Just send me a message. We'll get you in there. Come hang out. Make sure you introduce yourself. Tell us what you're playing, what your favorite games are, all that kind of thing. I'm just on Twitter. You can follow me at HistoryTablePod. Anything else, Rich?
No, just find me on Discord. But yeah, definitely join us there. And, you know, people are always looking for games, and you can look for games too. Play with us, play with other people. Lots of matchmaking going on there.
That's right. All right, folks, that's going to do it for us. Have a good one.
Good night, everyone.